is he part of my priority? Or is he in the second line? What about my thoughts? What do I think about when I start the day, my work? A lot of things come to our mind, even when we are still in bed. But is Jesus the Lord of our thoughts? What about the desires of our hearts? Do we recognize Him that He is my Lord of my desires? And how I communicate through verbal communication, my speech. Often my people say, well, I want to say whatever I want to say. But remember, if we accept Jesus as a Savior and friend, He is also our Lord for our speech. May the words of our mouth be a reflection of Jesus Christ, who is our Lord. And also our prayer. Not because prayer is an opportunity, it's free. It's a hotline to God. We can say, Lord, this is what I want. If you don't fulfill what I want, I'm sorry. But remember, He is the Lord of our prayer. So this quarter, we'll be focusing on that one. Lord of our relationships. How's my relationship with my spouse, with my children, with my community church family? Outside the church community, is He my Lord of my life? What about my resources? We're so thankful that the Lord has given us what? Good health and strength that you can find ways to provide our needs. And He had proven to us that if we remain faithful to Him, He said, prove me now if I will open the windows of heaven. And there's no room enough to receive it. Is he the Lord of your resources too? What about our body? A lot of people say, well, this is my body, I can do whatever I want to. If I put a lot of my colors in my body, remember, we are what? Precious body. How about our labor? And our worship. Amen. Remember something? I think last December we talked about this. And we come to worship. Whom do we worship? Do we worship ourselves and come to Sabbath school? No. We come to worship. If I don't like the preacher, I will not go to church. I don't like it. If the style of worship is not acceptable to my culture, I will not accept it. Now, what a privilege for me to witness the New York 13 last Sabbath when we had the joint camp meeting of Northeastern Conference in Greater New York and the celebration of the New York 13 at Nassau Veteran Memorial Coliseum, where we could accommodate 15,000. And not only that, a celebration of what the Lord done to New York City. Praise God that after the sermon of Elder Ted Wilson, we have 150 precious souls being baptized. And you see, a great family. One of my companions said, this is just like a mini general conference, where a lot of people come from different parts of the world. You know, one of our members recognized that Jesus is the Lord of her life. Mr. Hermione, come over here. We'd like to rededicate herself to Him. And I would like to invite all of us here. I wish we could invite everyone to come together. We are bringing Sister Hermione to you, a lady who is so passionate about reaching our community, feeding the homeless. I had a chance to go into it. What I call it, the name of the agency?
Judeo Christian.
Well, and I've seen 150 people there. And I said, watch her and listen to her passion in the ministry. He wants this church to be a community of influence. And that's what I learned also when I attended in New York, the International Film School Evangelism. They focused now about the urban mission. And my dream also in this church to be a center of influence or center of hope in this community. But beyond that, I want you to know that Sister Hermione will be having some medical procedure. And I would like to invite the elders to come and join me. And join with us too as we pray for it. Because this important day, well, she's very, very busy serving our community. We don't like Sister Bonnie to be neglected by our community. Let's come closer. I would like to have a special prayer. As a church family, we would like to be very much involved actively, not only outside the church, but even inside the church. And Sister Hermione is a part of our church. And she recognized that Jesus is Lord of her life. So we'd like to rededicate herself to Him today. Shall we kneel down together as we pray? Loving Father in heaven, what a precious privilege to come in your presence this beautiful Sabbath day, where you have given us the beautiful great nation, where we have freedom of worship, freedom to give thanks and honor to you. And at this point in time, we lift up to you your dear daughter, Sister Hermione. She has given her life to you, O God, and she recognizes that you are the Lord of her life. At this point in time, dear Lord, as she faced the challenge of her medical condition, we lift her up to you. Because you are our great physician. You know what's going on in her life, in her body. So we lift her up to you, believing that you know what's the best for her. May this anointing of oil be a symbol of your healing means, dear Lord. We are so thankful, dear Lord, that in our midst you could speak to us, for you have told us that in times that we need you, when you call upon me, I will listen. And you will not leave us to forsake us. So we humbly commit her to you, O God. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen.
As a church, we recognize that Jesus is our Lord. As we worship together, as we give glory and honor to our labor, no. When we work with different kinds of community and we recognize Him as also Lord of our body. That's why as a church we are so thankful that we could still give emphasis that Jesus is not only our Savior, only our friend, but He is the Lord of our life.
Amen.
I invite you to open with me from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 10. This particular passage in the scripture and the gospel is very important for us to understand in the study of the word. Okay, I invite you to open. I intentionally didn't put the screen because I know it's better for us to open a word, God's word together. I'm reading from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 10, verses 35 to 45 from the New King James Version. Then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to him saying, "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask." And he said to them, "What do you want me to do for you?" 37. They said to him, "Grant us that we may sit one on your right hand and the other on your left in your glory." 38. But Jesus said to them, "You do not know what you ask. You are able to drink the cup that I drink and be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with." They said to him, "We are able." So Jesus said to him, "You will indeed drink this cup that I drink and with the baptism I am baptized with, you will be baptized. But to sit on my right hand and my left is not mine to give, but it is for those whom it is prepared." And when the ten heard it, they began to be greatly displeased, in other words, indignant with James and John. 42. But Jesus called them to himself and said to them, "You know that those who are considered rulers over the Gentiles lord over them, and the great ones exercise authority over them. Yet it shall not be so among you, but whoever desires to be great among you shall be your servant. And whoever of your desires to be first shall be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life the ransom for many." I want you to take note some of the key words that I found out from the study of this gospel. Yes, Jesus Christ is Lord, but the key word I found out here is the word doulos. What does doulos mean? It's an opposite Lord, which means you are a slave. You know, in the Roman government during this time, when you're a slave, you have no rights. Whatever the master wants you to do, you'll do it. No question asked. And because you're a slave, you belong to your master, your Lord and Sir. And because of that, you have all the responsibilities and privileges granted by your master. At this point in time, it's very clear to us that if we accept that Jesus Christ as our Lord of our lives, of our priority, of our resources, of our body, our temple, everything, that out of those things, we're acknowledging that He is Lord of our life. And one thing good with the Lordship of Jesus is He knows us so much, but He didn't treat us just like a doormat. He loved us so much that He gave His life for us. Sad to say, when the spirit of service in the midst of these 12 disciples, verse 42, you'll focus on it. He said, you know that those considered rulers over Gentiles lorded over them, and the great ones exercised over authority over them. In the minds of people, when Jesus was talking to the disciples, in the minds of the disciples, to be a lord is, you be the boss. Do whatever I want you to do. Do whatever I say. No question asked. In our modern times, we have witnessed what happened in Egypt this week, right? They decided to head up, coup d'etat. They don't like it. But in Roman Empire, when they said, here's the slave needs to do, no question asked. Because they believe that He is Lord of my life. He had the privilege and the responsibility to do whatever He wants me to do. So, I want you to take note of this word when Jesus said, verse 43, it shall be not so among you. Oftentimes in our group, the group of disciples, remember they were asking, who's the greatest among us? That's why you noticed that the other 10 were indignant, they were greatly displeased because they themselves would like to be what? Be with Jesus on the left or the right hand. Everybody wants to be what? In power, in a position. When they end up being given power, what they will do? Okay, I will not go to church anymore. But Jesus said, not be so among you. Because the Lordship I'm talking here is that the concept of the secular world, that I'm the boss. There was something ago, somebody called me boss. I said, whom you're talking to? We are here equal at the foot of the cross. We are all sinners. We need saving grace of God day by day in our lives. I had a chance to be with the Tom Conference, standing and listening to the presentation of historical professor of theology at Vanderbilt University, and brought the issue of ordination. One thing he had conclusion is this: the issue of a present issue in our church is the ordination. And he found out this thing. Both pros and cons have the concept of authority. Wants to be ordained, wants authority. What's against them? They want, they don't like authority. But Jesus said, not be so among you. The ordination was brought for a specific function, not to lord over them. That's why in God's church, we are all equal at the foot of the cross. Because we're all sinners. I'm very thankful that Jesus showed to us the real essence of Lordship. Yes, He is the Lord of my life, but He will not dominate us or treat us dormant. Rather, He will help us to walk we need. In fact, he said, his saving grace is what we need day by day so that we could follow him. Remember, Apostle Paul, his grace is sufficient. That's one thing I like with Jesus. Yes, he is my Lord of my life, but he helps me at the start of the day. He gives me the power to follow. My inclination is to disobey. My intention was to disregard what God wants me. I want to do my own will. This is what I like. Is this what your Lord wants you to do? So remember, yes, Jesus, we accepted him and we baptized as our personal Savior. But don't ever forget that he is the Lord of our lives. That's why when the service, in the church service, in the community, wherever we go, not be so among you. And I'm very thankful to be there in New York during this International Field School of Evangelism. For the first time, the church got called the 13 divisions. And what a privilege for us to be with our world leaders, Elder Ted Wilson. But I didn't see that he's the boss among us. She's so, Elder Ted was so nice to be with a lot of people there at the market. And even the presentation, we acknowledged that, yes, Pastor Marco has been gifted. You know, we've been praying for him. Because like when we did the sermon, we pray together. We have a special prayer because of his present condition. I feel what God teaches us to do. Not so be among you. Yes, we have, we call it local church, conference. What's that? Union division. But that's not the intention that they are what? First, third, general, second, third. For there's no such thing in the concept of Jesus. When he called his church, he's called his people from darkness into this marvelous light. That's you and I. We know that we are all equal at the foot of the cross, that we need what saving grace day by day. And Jesus, who is Lord of our lives, very much willing one to show to us what is service. Now, you remember the story? When we talk about Jesus Christ as Lord of our service, remember a story in the Bible that talks about serving others in Jesus' name? There's one story of the sheep and the goats. The sheep of the goats start telling us what? This is not telling us about salvation. Please, I want you to clarify. There's nothing to do with our salvation. It's telling us how to be saved. Rather, it talks about what? That those who are saved have been involved in the life of service. I want you to take the story of the sheep and the goat. Find the gospel is telling us that those who are saved are what? Are involved in the life of service. And what a privilege for us in our community. We have so opportunity to be of service to God in different ways. According to your talent. Don't tell me that because I'm already above 80, I can't do anything for God. You have given the talent, and we need your prayer, your experience with God. So we need your prayer day by day. They call it prayer ministry. Those who want to be involved in nursing ministry or assisted living facility, thank you, Brother Mike. I had a chance to contact Julie Brother Wall. And we'll sit down together with our pastors in the area because he said we have 10 facilities, 7 nursing homes, 3 assisted living facilities, and they also do 2-day program. After having some telephone and to catch one another, we're able to talk and they're so very eager to work with us because you have seen how we're having this work. Now, for a teacher, we have a lot of opportunity. What I'm trying to tell you here is everyone will have a chance to be of service to God. So, from this story, let's look on the scripture. Matthew 25. I invite you again to open your Bible. 25, 31 to 40. And if you follow me, here's what it says. 31. When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, he will